friends, would you pray with me? As we have already prayed, for the earth's colors drawn forth by the sun, its brilliance piercing clouds of darkness and shimmering through leaves and flowing waters, thanks be to you, O God. Send us Jesus. Amen. It's beginning to be late October, so Rob is about to speak about
stewardship.
Okay, stewardship, that was a setup. The answer, the correct answer before you is foliage. Every year, right around this time, I'm amazed by the brilliance of God's masterpiece up on the trees. Longing to duct tape those trees back up, those leaves back up to the trees so they don't fall down and we lose those masterpieces that speak to the color glory of God. But, of course, they do fall, and this is the second time they've fallen for many of us this year in August. You may have noticed a lot of maple trees losing their leaves due to a fungus. Tar, not tar sands, but tar something. I can't remember the name. There's a, what was it? Tar spot. Thank you. Tar spot, this fungus upon some of the leaves. This is the second time those of us who are around leaves have had to rake them up. But again, even in the raking, we see the beautiful brilliance, the stained glass beauty of color in creation, and we remember God's generosity to us, even in creation. It's been nice for us to celebrate these days here at Church of the Covenant. It's been great this past week, this past Sunday, and last Saturday to celebrate 150 years of witness to God's glory and the colored diversity in creation in this particular footprint here for the past 150 years. We give great thanks to God for those saints who've gone before us. I really want to celebrate what happened last weekend here as a church community. We saw the explosion of generosity once again as this community showed up in body and in prayer and in spirit in this space on the 14th as we gathered to celebrate breakfast with Tiffany's, accompanied by these light givers, and reminded ourselves on Sunday that we too are called to be Tiffany's out in the world to receive God's light, let it shine through us, and to go out into our world. In the course of that weekend, we raised $20,000, $20,000 to the stewardship of this particular place as we go forward. And I just want to say thanks be to God and thanks be to you for that incredible generosity. The word generosity, the root word, originated sometime in the 1600s in the English language, taken from the French and the Latin, a mixture of the two, and it actually first meant nobility, to be of noble descent. It spoke about race and ethnicity and place in the world. If you were generous, it means you had a lot of money and you had a lot of privilege. We're grateful for the way that the English language changes with the time and with the people. Now, generosity is those often without who give to others without, in a spirit of generosity, of self-giving, of giving more. So it no longer is tied to nobility or to privilege. It is tied as a gift to all of us and a potential for all of us. It's good to celebrate generosity, especially in our world and in our nation where we see such a lack of it coming from certain leaders in our world right now. Before I say anything more about the White House and its ties to white nationalism, I want to pause, because some of you already may be getting those goosebumps of discomfort, because many of you and some out there like to say that religion and politics ne'er the twain shall meet. When I come into a sanctuary, I want to tune out the world and focus in on God, Creator. And let me tell you, I am the first to agree with that sentiment. I want us to be people who turn away at times and turn toward God and remember our worship and remember God who shines in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of politics. It was such a gift to get away to that foliage-rich environment up in Canada 2 weeks ago as a family and unplug from cell phones and internet and not hear a thing about our nation and hatred and the world and disparity and injustice. We need to take those breaks, dear friends. But as a church, I think it's wrong for us to say no to engaging with the political realities of our world, because politics is simply about people and what happens to people who have power and how it affects people without power. And even when we want to turn away, every time we turn to our scriptures over and over again, we hear that intersection of faith and politics, of church and state. Today, we turn to Matthew and hear Jesus engaging around taxes, seemingly a very relevant thing in today's world, as we hear of taxes quite a bit. Politicians who want to slash taxes and give more money to the uber rich, take away the poor's health care, deny federal resources to Puerto Rico, federal tax paying place in our country right now. It's relevant for us then to tune in to what is Jesus talking about when he refers to taxes. Friends, we can't ignore the political and faith connections in our world and in our scripture. As we tune into this scripture from Matthew, this loaded scripture, this well-known scripture from Matthew, we remember the context. Jesus is not going off script here just talking about taxes. He is being set up. We're in a rare showing of unity, the Herodians and Pharisees, often on two different political sides of the spectrum, come together to entrap Jesus once again. We remember the Pharisees were the ones who were not fond of paying taxes to a foreign occupying power. The Herodians were those who followed after Herod Antipas, the one called King of the Jews, who were often seen as local puppets of the Roman Empire, and therefore did support paying tribute. And so, in this context, these two groups come together to try to trap Jesus as they set him up by saying he's impartial, and then they say, what should we do about taxes? Should we pay them or not? And we see Jesus' incredible response. Once again, speaking truth to power and serving up an incredible challenge to all of those who would listen. He asks his fowlers, beware the snare of the fowler here. Jesus asks his fowlers to show him a coin. So pull out a silver denarii, and Jesus asks whose faith and face and title is on it, and of course they respond, the emperor. Well then, give to the emperor what is the emperor's. Or as perhaps we learned it as in King James, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. We can imagine perhaps a dismissive tone in this. I wish our scriptures would sometimes give us the facial expressions of those saying these words. Give to Caesar's what is Caesar's, but give to God what is God's. Often these lines are given to support a duality of living, that we as followers of Jesus should live our lives in one sphere and in another, in our political sphere, where we pay taxes, where we obey the law, where we talk about these things, not at the dinner table, but in certain spheres, and then in another sphere, our religious faith life, which is sacred and spiritual, is between us and God, and maybe shared in community or in sanctuaries, but ne'er the twain shall meet. And I don't think this is what Jesus is advocating for in this text. I think, once again, Jesus is tearing down binaries and bringing together for us a world that is unified and not dualistic. Give to God what is God's. This is not ultimately a question about taxes. For Jesus, it's about allegiance and identity. Jesus is talking about who we belong to and what we want to live for. Become stewards of all that is God's. God, the Creator, we remember. This is the one to whom all remember as God. God, the one whose realm is all-encompassing, who created the very heavens and the earth, who crafted out of the dust the human in which we encounter and in which we embody. The owner of all that is. Become, therefore, a cosmic eco-steward of all that is, all that has been given to us. Give unto God. Yes, give to Caesar what is Caesar. What is Caesar's? The limited things, the things that bear the image of empire, the things that oppress others, the things that deny people access. We remember, too, here on this coin is a heretical statement. Tiberius Caesar, son of the divine, or Son of God, Augustus. So even in Jesus calling out his fellow Jewish interrogators, he is calling out their heresy by even holding these coins in their pocket. They were claiming there was someone other than God. They, in living in empire, had to confess this reality. The Son of God is Caesar. Of course, that is what caused the early church to find such oppression. The early Jewish communities that followed after this new rabbi named Jesus, they were oppressed because of their confession, because of what they said and believed. They were seen as a threat. So hard to avoid the political realities when we know that Jesus was crucified on a cross, a political death, killed as a subversive, threatening the empire. And so we remember what so many people have said about this text. People have commented on this text throughout the ages. And I want to pull out one quote by Leo Tolstoy, who writes, "If Christ recognized the obligatoriness of paying tribute, and so of obedience, he would have said directly, yes, the tax should be paid. But notice he says, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, that is, the money, and give your life to God. And with these latter words, he does not encourage any obedience to power, but on the contrary, points out that in everything which belongs to God, it is not right to obey Caesar." Tolstoy and many others have commented that this text actually tells us to disobey the powers that be when they call us into ways of imperial injustice. We know the Quakers, we know the Mennonites, many of them have seen this and said, we will no longer pay war tax. I know faith, your tradition as you grew up, knew this. We will not pay taxes to an empire that spends money on war. So there is inherent in this text a motivation toward a specific civil disobedience. In today's world, I'm grateful for the many voices who are calling us to think about what we as people of our faith are called to in today's political reality. I give thanks specifically to God for Reverend Dr. William Barber of the Moral Revival Movement, who was just here this past week. Some of us were there gathered in Trinity on Thursday night, where he laid out a new poor people's campaign, a national call to moral revival. This campaign will be taking place in 2018 in concert with the 50th anniversary of the gun violence-related death of Dr. King. 1968. It will coincide with that, and on Mother's Day of next year, this 40-day campaign will begin, where many people of faith will be called to think about civil disobedience, to be called to what is the obedience to whom we are called, what source of allegiance do we confess. Dr. Barber is saying this is not a partisan issue at all. This is a moral agenda where we are called to live out the ways of love, to think about the poor, to think about the earth, to think about those stuck in poverty and systemic racial injustice. I'm so grateful for this movement. I'm grateful for the people leaning into this movement here in Boston, the local organizers who are thinking about those in the midst. And what is unique about this movement, as it was unique in the Poor People's Campaign of 1967 and 68, is that the poor will be a part of this and will be the leaders that we will be following and we will be walking alongside. This is not a movement that works for the poor, but one that works with the poor. So it is a movement that we are called to. As we hear the word Caesar in our text today, I'm struck by another Caesar Chavez, who also worked alongside with the poor in California to raise up awareness of the legal reality of organizing. It was illegal at that time for migrant workers to organize. And so he lovingly helped others disobey the civil laws of that time to bring about God's sense of law, of justice, of equality, of radical provision. And so, friends, as we look at today's world, we remember the coins in our pocket. Many of them since 1956 and beyond say, "In God we trust." I won't go into the inconsistencies that Theodore Roosevelt talked about in that perhaps sacrilegious statement, yet it is a good thing to remember. Yes, it is in God we trust. It is not in emperors that we trust. It is in God that we we trust. And another way to think about this is, what image is on that coin, and who bears God's image? In fact, who bears God's face? And what do we value in our world? I, like many of you, have been struck and sickened by how many people posted hashtag MeToo over this past week, a pervasive social media affirmation of the reality of sexual harassment in our world. For many, the majority of those who self-identify as women in my Facebook feed had posted MeToo. They have been hit with, sadly, the pervasive presence of sexual harassment in our world. Not only those who self-identify as women, but the majority for me was that. And so it is for us as a church to recognize this reality, yes, a political reality in our world, and a social reality in our world, and say it is not just, it is not right, and we, those who self-identify as men, are sorry for this reality and for the times where we have remained silent to its pervasive force, and we rededicate ourselves as a church, as a community, to get rid of these realities, to say no to such harassment in our world, because women's bodies wear the face of God. So too, people of color wear the face of God. I'm grateful for the NFL and this movement of those who are courageously taking the knee during the singing of national anthems to draw our national attention to the ongoing injustice of unjust police killings of people of color. People are losing their jobs as a result of this. People are now taking a knee after they sing the national anthem, not just athletes, but musicians. There is a movement afoot to draw our society's attention to the injustices here. And so, like Reverend Barber, we cry out, first of all, to these realities with lamentation. In Amos 5:10, we remember those iconic words often shared by Martin Luther King, actually Amos 5:24, but let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. But before this affirmation, Reverend Barber points out that Amos implored the people to get out into the streets and lament, to cry out the injustices around us. For in crying out and pointing to the realities, only then can we get to that justice that rolls down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. We long for a breakthrough. Reverend Barber says that we need a breakthrough in this country. We need less greed and more generosity. We need more people being generous in the face of the real political challenges and fears in our world. Friends, generosity can be contagious. I give thanks to God for that. I give thanks to the generosity that's being shared week by week here during our generosity season. Those of our generosity team have been sharing profiles of you who are generous in this world. Notice that the people that are shared about each week, and today we'll hear about Joan Hill. Those who are being shared about, these profiles, are not people who are being generous here in the life of our congregation, although so many of you are. These are particularly people in our congregation who are being generous out in the world. And our team is sharing that with you, and you will hear more about that in a letter that's going out this week to us related to stewardship and generosity. We are profiling these people and their work in the world because generosity is contagious. And if we, as people of faith, hear about people's actions of generosity out in the wider world, into the political realities, into the social realities in our world, we pray that we too will open our lives more to generosity, self-giving, to living our lives for others and alongside in solidarity with others. I give thanks to God for this season of generosity where we move away from a sense of nobility and move toward a sense of God's provision and God's face in all people. What is God's? What are we giving back to God? What belongs to God, and how are we giving? Friends, may we give out of expectation for God's presence. May we give in selflessness, knowing that we are given so much. And may we find that edgy form of self-giving that acknowledges that to give to God is to give to love, and is to give to the very sense of who we are in this world. For all good gifts around us, we give great thanks to God for the generosity that is in the very image of God within us.